no sunshine when she's gone, and she's always gone too long. Anytime she runs away. Oh, hit me, Kiki, the crazy man on the radio. Yes, crazy like a fox. Lord have mercy. Eat your heart out, Lil Wayne. This year I'm going national. That's my prediction. I'm taking Melanated Media News and the whole crew with me. Hey! But you can't keep my talent down too long. Hey! Talent from God. I didn't come here to cuddle you. I came here to tell you the truth. Because the truth shall set you free. Came out with I think it was OJ, came out with this song. Backstabber, you smile in my face, always want to take my place.
Yeah.
That's when it all started. Because listen, if there's no trust in the community, then there can be no village raise a child, okay?
Mm-hmm.
And so that's what happened. Yeah. No trust in the community. Mm-hmm. That ended village to raise a child. Mm-hmm. You understand? A backstabber, you understand? Mm-hmm. You smile in my face.
Right.
All the time you want to take my place, you understand?
Mm-hmm.
Backstabber, you know.
Not front stabbers, backstabbers.
Backstabbers, yeah. Backstabbers, you understand? So that was the era, mm-hmm, in which...
That was the change?
That was the beginning of the change of village to raise a child. Because, mm-hmm, see, when you talk about village to raise a child,
mm-hmm,
you're talking about next door, trusting next door,
mm-hmm,
neighbor, trusting neighbor, that relationship.
Mm-hmm.
But once the backstabbing got in there,
mm-hmm,
neighbor stopped trusting neighbor, community stopped trusting community. It was all individual,
mm-hmm,
you understand? So it was no more about this.
So the moral of the story is the OJs are the blame for...
No, the OJ, listen, music is never the blame.
Okay.
Music is a remnant of what's happening,
right,
in the community.
Right.
In other words, James Brown,
right,
I'm black and I'm proud.
Right.
You understand? You're not going to ask me to James Brown, you're not going to ask me to James Brown create that atmosphere. No, but his music,
mm-hmm,
challenged it. Just like the music of today, you understand? They didn't create this, but they're challenging... channeling what's going on. Am I making it clear to you now?
Yes, sir.
All right.
Yes, sir.
No doubt about it. Who's on the phone line? Talk to me. Yes,
this
hello.
This is Melissa. I'm Jasmine Conaway's mother.
Jasmine Conaway's mother.
Correct.
Lord have mercy. We could just, and I'm Art McCoy. You're on the Art McCoy University radio show. Millions of listeners. And I'm just so proud of you and the people that went out with you, Sam and all of them went out with and looked for your daughter. And it's just...
I am blessed. And I would like to say, you know, Samuel, he did an amazing job with Cleveland.com and covering this story. Cassandra McDonald, she did an amazing job. Al Porter, I was shocked with the support from the community. I was truly shocked with the people of the community. You know, I am so blessed that my daughter is home.
Your daughter is home.
Correct.
So you're announcing to our millions of listeners that your daughter is home. Lord, have mercy. You don't know how that makes us feel to know that your daughter is home. I know how it makes you feel, but it really makes us feel good. So it's so beautiful. And she's
It's amazing, but you know what? There is still other children out there missing. The other child that went missing with Jasmine, Sade Franklin, she is still missing. She is 15 years old, and she is still missing. You know, there are other children out there. This has opened my eyes to, you know, I thought I understood how it was for other people when I would watch and I would see these missing posters. You don't know how it feels until you're in that situation. There is no words to explain the emotions, the feeling, it's, you know, and Sade needs to be found. You know, there's another young lady, 13 years old, that just went missing from the east side of Cleveland. You know, these children are out there, and everybody needs to come together and search and find these children.
Yes, so along with opening up your eyes, it also made you to become a part of the action to find these children. Because I agree with you 100%. Having a missing child myself at one time, you don't know the feeling until you get it yourself, do you?
Correct. That's correct. You know, I've had sympathy. I've worked in EMS for 13 years, and I've seen a lot of stuff and experienced a lot of stuff, and I've had so much pain and sympathy and heartache for these parents who have had missing children. But it's completely different when it's your child, when you don't know if your child's eaten, if they're alive, if they're, you know, Aliana, you know, her parents came out. They supported us. They helped us, you know, and God rest her soul. You know, it's a nightmare. It's an everyday nightmare, not knowing.
Yes, you can't sleep, you can't eat. Every phone call you think maybe it might be her. When you see a child that look like her, you think it might be her. It's something that unless you've been through it, and I'm talking because I've been through it, then you just don't understand, do you?
Correct. That's correct.
Yes, ma'am. How long was your child missing?
10 days.
Oh my goodness, that's enough to kill. That's enough to kill you.
I lost it. You know, my husband, he tried everything to get me to, you know, I was devastated. You know, I've been on the news. I've been trying to put this out there, you know, and I appreciate all the media that have covered this. You know, it's great, but it needs to be covered like this for every missing child. Mm-hmm. You know, I was blessed. God blessed me by bringing Jasmine home. But the rest of these children, they need to be brought home too.
Yes, yes, yes. So so now we have you as an active participant in helping us bring these children home, and we love that.
I've already reached out to Cassandra McDonald, and I told her I want to continue this search for Sade Franklin. You know, I want to continue in any and every search that I can. These children need to be found. You know, they don't need to be lost on these streets, and I don't want to say anything negative in regards to police departments, but they need to be out there and they need to be searching for these children.
Well, we understand clearly what you're trying to say. They need to do more, and that's why the efforts of you, Mom, and the others that went out there ahead, that makes the police do more. Okay, if we don't do anything, they do less, okay? So that effort that you, Mom, and Dad, and all of you all put out there, that was the leading effort that led to where we're at today, okay?
Yes, and I understand that, but unfortunately, there's some children that don't have
anyone
to advocate for them, and that's why the community needs to come together and advocate for them.
So let's talk for just a moment about the young lady that was missing, that came missing with your daughter. So she's been out there now 10 days also, right?
Correct. Sade Franklin is her name.
Sade Franklin. Does she have a family unit structure as yours that can push hard as you, or do we have to do it?
I can't speak on behalf of her family because I've only spoke with her mother one time, so I can't speak on behalf of her family. But I do believe she needs the community out there looking for her. You know, I do believe she is still endangered. And she needs us to come together and find her. She needs, you know, she might have issues going on, but she can get through them if we can help her get through them. She's 15 years old.
Yes, we don't care about no issues, like you say. We've all had issues and that we had to work through. So that doesn't matter to us. Let's bring her home and we can really work through these issues, all right?
Right, exactly.
All right, so in closing, I just want in your own way to say whatever you want to the millions of listeners that's listening to you right now that feels so good with the good news that you brought to us. Would you tell us again and in your own way just thank the community and say whatever you want to say. Go ahead.
I want to thank everyone, and I want to thank God, and, you know, anyone who has other higher powers. You know, it took everyone, everyone's effort to bring Jasmine home, and it's ironic because when I was waiting to talk to you, I heard a little portion of your show, and somebody was saying it takes a village to raise a child, and it does. It takes a village, and we all need to be out there, and we all need to be working together. It doesn't matter what color you are, what sex you are. It doesn't matter, you know, who you choose to love. None of that matters. What matters is everyone needs to work together. We need to work together, and we need to protect our children. You need to give your child a hug and kiss every single day. You need to tell them you love them, because anything can happen.
Yes, and your daughter's home.
Correct, Jasmine is home.
Thank God your daughter is home, and we really appreciate you coming on the air, talking to us. Anytime in the future that you need to tell us anything, you're welcome to come on the air and talk to us about anything you want to talk about, okay?
Thank you, and I greatly appreciate you taking the time to put this out there and let the community know she's home. And again, you know, Samuel from Cleveland.com, he was amazing.
Melanated Media News.
Denise from Channel 19, she's amazing. All of these people have been amazing. I can't say it enough. It's Al Porter. You know, I did not expect Al Porter to be there, and he was. You know, everybody. You know, Fox 8 was there. You know, everybody was there. And it's amazing. And everybody needs to keep doing this. We need to cover every child that's missing.
Again, you want to say something, Sam?
I appreciate everything. Also, everybody coming out, taking the time out in the cold. Saturday, everybody could have been with their family or enjoying the weekend off from work. So I think it's good when we come together, everybody come together, play their positions or whatever they're good at, and, you know, making things like this happen.
So ma'am, in closing, just give your name and give us your daughter's name and tell the whole millions of listeners who might just have toned in a minute ago that she's home. Go ahead in your own way.
My name is Melissa Fuentes. My daughter, Jasmine Conaway, who was missing for 10 days, is finally home. She's finally home, and she's safe.
Lord have mercy. Thank you so much, dear. We will be in touch, okay?
Okay, thank you so much.
All right, thank you.
Great.
The Art McCoy University Radio Show, the University of Common Sense. Who are you, son?
Samuel from Melanated Media News.
Lord have mercy. You're doing great work, Sam. Oh, the Art McCoy University Radio Show, the University of Common Sense. This is the kind of work we do. We're the only show that does what we do. There used to be a lot of shows that do what we do, but they went to fun and games and all of that. We do what we do. Who's on the line? Talk to me. Oh, we give you fun and games sometime, but when it comes to business, we're about business. Who's on the line? Talk to me. Yes, who's on the line? Talk to me. Yes, hello? Who's on the line?
Belmont.
Cuyahoga County saw its deadliest month ever for heroin and fentanyl-related overdose death, with 60 confirmed fatal overdoses in February. First of all, let me say that somewhere down the line, we will do a show on the heroin epidemic. I am an expert in that field, being that I was a former heroin addict myself, and so there's a lot to talk about in that area. And one of the main things that I want to say is the fact that, being one myself, I realize that the pain and suffering that all nationalities, all people go through. Let me make that clear. I want to make it clear one more time. Being an addict myself, I realize the pain and suffering that all nationalities, all races go through. So I'm not prejudiced when it comes to healing of those that are suffering, no matter what nationality you might be. Let me make that perfectly clear. If you are an addictive, I don't care if you're white, blue, or green, or black, and you need some help, if there's anything I can do to help, or anything my knowledge can do to help in this area, being a recovered person, then I will gladly do this. But as I say that, I want to say this, that in reality, there's only one way for the suburbanites and the people that's addicted with this heroin epidemic today like a plague. It is very simple to me that in order for them to heal, they must first come forth. And what they must do is they must first come forth, and I lost my word all of a sudden that I'm looking for.
You want them to acknowledge what happened in the black community.
But atone. That's my word. Getting old, I'm forgetting my word. They must, the suburbanites and those in those communities, they must first come forth and atone for the sins of their communities. Atoning, once you come and atone to God and atone, then what happens is you will be forgiven and your land and your community can be healed. So what am I saying? I'm saying that all the time that the black community and the inner city was suffering from this drug addiction and drug overdoses and the destruction of generations of our children, the suburbanites as a whole, they snobbed at us. They said, oh, it's just happening in that community. It's just those people, those no good people. They don't know. Shame on them. And they turned their nose of us. And for 20 years or more, we had to go through this on our own. Our children and our children's children, our grandmamas, went through this addiction process and just tore our community together. But no one from those suburbanite communities even stepped up as a whole to help. But listen, there's a God somewhere, and the God said he will not let his people suffer but so long before he'll step in. So this plague that the suburbanites are feeling right now, it is a plague that the best way for them to overcome is to amend for their sins. And with that being said, of course, they must finally think about the revenues that they must bring into the inner city to help our people who have been suffering from this addiction for so long. I'm going to give you an example, then I'm going to leave it alone because I know I'm too deep on a Sunday. The young people that you see in our community right now is shooting and killing and doing this and acting crazy. Those are crack babies. Those babies grew up, those 20 and 22 and 23, all those babies grew up in the heart of the crack era, heart of the drug-infested area in our communities when mamas and daddies and grandpapas were all addicted, but they couldn't get no help. So this generation of young people that you see coming up now, you say, oh, they're crazy. Oh, what's wrong with them? They're actually a product of the drug epidemic that went through our neighborhood that we didn't get no help for. So this is a result. So if the suburbanite community don't see this and amend for their sins, then 20 years from now when their children grow up, they might reap the same fate. Oh, I'm too heavy for you on a Sunday. This is the professor talking. Listen, don't y'all go back and say that I'm trying to slam no addicted person. All addicted people need help. But I'm telling you, suburbanites, in order for your community to heal, you must take the steps that I say, that I give to you right now. Who's on the phone line? Talk to me. Who's on the phone line? Talk to me.
But it's a credit to our community that we are embracing and that these families are meeting. And it's necessary because the people who are supposed to be looking for kids and taking care of our community, you know, they're not doing their job. So here's an article. Here's an article in the on Channel 3 called Cleveland Police Ticketing and Arresting Fewer. And it says Cleveland Police are writing a lot fewer tickets and arresting fewer individuals, according to records reviewed by Channel 3 News. And the president of the police union says it's no accident. I'm going to try to play his words. I hope you can hear this.
We're not doing it because we don't want to be accused of being unconstitutional. We don't want to be accused of being biased and how and who we're stopping and why. Police call it the first
term. Were you able to hear that?
Yes, we heard that. We sure did.
You know, so that's police union president Detective Loomis saying we don't want things. We're not going to do our job. We don't want to be accused of being biased. A little later it says, the article says, Loomis says officers are still responding to radio calls, but are less likely to do what he calls, quote, proactive policing, end quote, taking the initiative to investigate anything that doesn't involve a 911 call.
Yes, I'm listening.
Yeah.
Yes.
So that's the most vocal police person in the community, because we rarely hear from Chief Williams, and we never hear from the safety director. So what we see as the voice of the Cleveland Police Department is Loomis, the union president. So if the police aren't doing proactive policing, missing girls is one outcome. And I just think it's great that black-on-black crime and Judy Martin with the Victims and Survivors Group, that you guys are there every day for these families in need. And Melanated Media News and, you know, everybody in the community. The community, that's what this is all about. And it's thrilling to see the community taking part. And then it's wonderful when there's a successful result like there was today.
Thank you.
That's all I got for you, buddy.
Thank you so much. I appreciate you. All right.
Okay, man.
All right,
everybody.
All right. Who's on the phone line? One line open. We're gonna try to get.
Was held accountable for that tragedy, and we don't bring drugs into this community. They come from an outside source. And this is a time when we need to vent to make the government accountable for what they actually did to the communities, because they're talking about going into Chicago, tearing up the town, arresting people. But they never were held accountable for this, and it was truly a tragedy, an epidemic that happened in our communities today. And they should be held accountable. And on that, I'd like for you to respond.
Thank you so much for your phone call, sir. I appreciate you. Again, atonement. You have to atone for your sins. Atonement, that is the key. And then after atonement, then you have to, once you atone, then you have to come in and say, yes. The other part of the atonement is I'm going to come in with some revenue, and if I don't do anything else, I'm going to come in with some revenue and help these lost young men and women that were a product of this drug epidemic. Let's try to make them whole again. I try to make them back into a part of the workforce. Try to make them whole again. There's a lot we could talk about in this area as we go forth. Who's on the phone line? Talk to me. One line open, 216-578-1490. Yes, sir, Demetrius.
Yeah, I was calling out. In your opinion, what percentage of the crime in the community you think is connected with drugs? Because do you believe that, like, I feel like a lot of the abuse that take place, you know, in the community, and also the crime that does occur because someone is trying to get money to buy drugs, and also you have the street killings, sometimes related to turf wars about drugs. So if drugs drug problem was really reducing community. I believe it will cut down on a lot of crime, except for the poverty. You know, people don't have no money, but I believe drugs, you know, the epidemic caused a lot of crimes in the community and also break down the family structure. Because a lot of children who grew up in homes.
Brother Demetrius, I'm going to teach you to be politically correct, okay? You don't think this, you know this. Come on, man. The professor don't have to give you this. You don't think this, you know this. Come on. Listen, this is a station of balls. We got basketball, football, and I want you to get some, okay? It ain't about thinking, it's about knowing. You know this. Stop hearing and hawing, okay? Be for real. Make it rain, okay? Come on with it, man. I don't have time to pacify you. Instead, you know that drugs cause havoc in our community. You know they make steal. You know all this, Demetrius. I'm not here to pacify. Take that to kindergarten. This is the professor. You insulted me. I'm a professor, okay? This is the College of Common Sense. You're supposed to learn that in kindergarten. Go to DARE class and learn the questions that you're asking me. Ask your DARE instructor. Don't ask me, okay? I'm a professor, all right? Kindergarten, I'm telling you, man, my DARE instructor, go to East Cleveland, ask for the DARE officer and ask these questions, not the professor, okay? Come heavier with the professor. Listen, you've graduated from kindergarten. You know all this, man. My 7-year-old son know these questions.
Politicians might not tell me the truth.
That's why our guest in the next hour is going to tell you, you are too stressed about Trump. You're too stressed about this politician. Darn that. It's about us. It's about... Yes, you are. And half of the community. Listen, Demetrius, call me back when you graduate from high school and come to the college, okay? Right now, kindergarten, he failed today. Kindergarten, don't ask me no acid-down questions about does drugs cause havoc to our community. Come on, you're going to make me cuss. You're going to make me say, hell, can I say that on the radio? Is the FEC going to banish me for saying that, Kiki? Because this kid, I don't have time for kindergarten stuff.
How old is he? Maybe.
You understand? I don't care. Okay. My son's 7 years old. He know that. Don't ask me no acidine questions like that. This is a million-dollar radio show. Million to listen. I don't have time for that. Who's on the line? Talk to me. Get your prepare better. Or you'll flunk this class. Who's on the line? The University of Common Sense. One of my lawyer friends called me and said, hey, you need to listen to 1420. They're talking about you on a talk show. They're talking about if you had the money that Obama had, you'd be as liberal as he is. Something crazy, man. So they're talking about me everywhere. But that's all right. A small basis, but we're going to start addressing it a little bit deeper right now.
Keep in mind what I mentioned to you. I called in the back end of the broadcast, and I said that if you really want to have a serious conversation about black-on-black crime in this particular city, we should have some part of that conversation contributed to the fact that we have a big problem with the way that folks start to conceive their families and maintain their families. That's economically, emotionally, and time fit.
Okay, let's break it down since you're on the air. Conceive, what are you talking about?
I'm talking about making it before the child's born, the child has to be conceived. And there are a lot of folks that have children that grow up to be problems in society for one as adults. And if you could trace it back to the fact that the parents didn't have a good plan of any kind in making this person, they didn't have a good plan of any kind financially putting themselves forward, and they didn't have a good plan of any kind of how they were going to manage their time.
Okay, all right. We're going to break it down one at a time since you're on this subject. So we're talking about conceiving. You're a pretty deep guy.
I'm actually rather shallow, to be truthful, but go ahead.
All right, so out of conceivement in, say, in our community, how many parents do you think really go through the thought process when they are conceiving to do what you're asking, percentage wise?
I don't know. But
it's very important because I tell you,
they're in the minority based on these facts. There's
But wait. I want to deal with this conceiving right now. Then, tell me about it. So me and my wife is fitting to conceive. So tell me what that process should be like.
Well, I'm not going to explain conception on the radio for you, but what
I'm not asking. I'm not. Listen. Now you brought me something deep. Now you're talking to the professor. Don't do like my other.
I'm asking you.
You brought up conceiving. Me and my wife is going to conceive a child. Like you say that many in our community as a whole conceive children. What should our plan be?
You should have a concept of what it's going to cost under ideal circumstances, because sometimes it's ideal, most times it's not, okay? Under ideal circumstances, what it's going to cost to get this person from 0 to 18, you know, considering health care, education, and clothing costs. You should take in consideration those things. You should take in consideration how much time are we going to really be able to spend with this person, again, under ideal circumstances, most of them aren't. And then you should also take in consideration to what degree are we willing to commit a better effort to maintain ourselves so that we can maintain this person better. Those are conversations that sometimes need to have. But you don't necessarily have to have it with your wife. You can have it amongst your friends before you even meet the woman or man that you want to get involved with. Because if you have that concept in your mind already, how it may need to go, then you'll look out somebody who's a like thinker like you when you're ready to get it done, and you're less likely to get somebody pregnant unintentionally.
Now you're talking. Go ahead.
Now that's what I'm talking about. That's why I say prior to conception, because you got to get somebody pregnant before somebody can give birth.
I understand that.
And then moving forward, I wasn't sure, Art. I'm glad you do. But moving forward, and then in addition to that, you have to take in consideration, well, what kind of community do we want to live in? Do we want to live middle class? And what does it cost to be middle class in Cleveland? And they're real bottom line numbers that you could point to that will give you the answers to that question in the city of Cleveland, to the cost of bringing a child up from 0 to 18. All the county websites in this country will tell you what it costs to get a kid from 0 to 18 at relatively middle class status. And there's a lot of good public schools in this area that are in reasonably good neighborhoods. You know, things like that. And, you know, check out the chicks or the dudes' background genetically before you start talking about getting down with them, because they may have some bipolar that you may not want to deal with in your bloodline. Things or alcoholism that you may not want to deal with in your bloodline. Or strong criminal tendencies that aren't necessarily because of bipolar or any kind of drug addiction. Just real straightforward questions that are kind of hard when you meet that person, but if you already have it in your head prior to you meeting anybody that you think you want to get pregnant or get pregnant with, then you can kind of seek out somebody who's like-minded, and you got a better chance of producing a good citizen and a greater chance of not producing somebody who's going to contribute to the crime statistics.
Sam,
that's just something we should talk about.
I like it. Let me ask you one question, though. Are you married?
Nah, man.
How old are you?
Old enough to be married, but not going to be. That's all I'm answering for that, man. You're on a broad radio broadcast.
Listen, I'm not. I didn't ask that. I'm not being cynical. I'm just, you're bringing up deep stuff, man, so I'm trying
this
to figure out.
It's not deep, Art.
It got to be deep because you're not married.
Art, the reason.
Wait a minute, all I'm saying is this. Go ahead, son.
Let me tell you why it's not deep.
Go ahead.
The reason why it's not deep, because it only takes a shallow assessment of the facts to get to what I'm talking about.
It doesn't
require a deep analytical research to find out what the estimated cost is to get a kid from 0 to 18 in this county alone. It doesn't require any deep analytical thinking to just sit down and think, what do I want her to look like, or what do I want him to look like genetically, financially, and from a good in the family background?
Okay, Sam is dying. Sam is dying.
That being said, I think you have found your calling. All the times you've called here, This has been the most in-depth that you've explained anything. The past, Talking John is shaking his head. Do you agree, Art?
Yes, it's great.
It's great. So with that being said, and since you're saying it's not hard, I think you should put, this is it. I think you found something you want to do. And then in doing this, maybe you'll find your wife.
I hope you're not being presumptuous into thinking this isn't something that I already do. I have a volunteer project that's a long-standing 20-year-plus volunteer project where I work to get black kids and their fathers out of the family court system. And this is a big part of what we talk about and instruct them on in my volunteer group. So this is something I've been doing since I was back in my 20s. You know, this is not something new to me. And I know it helps. There's no guarantees that somebody's going to turn out well. But it helps a lot when you have this kind of type of long-range thinking to get you away from the possibility of being a kid that grows up to be a criminal or hangs out with criminals. I'm talking about, you know, it don't take much to be a criminal in this country, but I'm talking about a criminal that really just goes out and mess up the country.
Todd, your points are well taken, are very well taken, all right? Your points are well taken. I have to move on, but listen.
I got a question for Sam before I go off the air.
Yeah, okay.
Hey, Sam, mm-hmm. if an opportunity presents itself, mm-hmm. could you get in there and talk with that dude, if it turns out that he is the guilty party, Chris Whitaker, and find out what his background was and post it on your website? How'd he grow up?
I would love to. I would love to do that. As we have spoke before, I was in favor of doing research on the people, you know, with the Anthony Sowa and all this different stuff. Rather than just executing them, I was in favor of researching, picking their brains, finding out their history, behavior patterns, different things like that.
I really like, you got the website for that, man. If you don't, try and push for it. If you could get in, get to him. Assuming he's the guilty party. All right, yes. I'll go back to listening. I can't believe you let me talk this long. I'll talk to y'all later.
About the fact that, about what's happening political-wise. And righteously still, we can understand that. But the fact of the matter is, whatever Trump does or doesn't do, we must go on with our community. So I bring in my guest, Brother Zaid. I bring in my guest, Brother Zaid, and he's going to expound on that a little bit further. Hold on 1 minute. Wife, you know I'm on the air. What's up? The baby fractured her knee? All right, listen, Yvonne. I guarantee you I'll be home very shortly. Okay. Put some ice it up and wrap it. Okay. I gotta go. All right. This is live radio. That's how we like to keep it. All right. The baby has injured her knee. Come on, Brother Zaid, talk to me.
Peace and blessings. Assalamu alaikum. Hotep. Jambo. Gavibarigani.
Pull that closer to you. It'll come down.
We always begin with Allah's name, that is God, the merciful benefactor, the merciful redeemer. All the praise and thanks are due to Allah, God, cherisher, sustainer, Lord of all the worlds, who has sent prophets and messengers with guidance from Adam to Muhammad, to man, his human creation, after they have strayed from the path of human excellence. Peace be upon them all. Amen. Thanks for the opportunity to come to the radio, University of Common Sense. Common sense today has to be an expanded form of common sense because we're in a different time now. So we need to progress in our common sense approach and our common sense logic. And thanks to the many community leaders, social reformers, activists, for their constancy in trying to bring about a better situation in our community life. I will begin with reading a surah, which is a chapter from the Quran, our holy book. It's called Walasa. It says, it begins with God's name, the merciful benefactor, the merciful redeemer. Verily, man is in loss, except such as have faith and do righteous deeds, and join together in the mutual teaching of truth, of patience, and constancy. Now, traditionally, the black church, as you know, has been a major saving force in our community. And that community life was very well demonstrated by caring social activists of its concerns. In our holy book, the Quran, Allah said, those that are nearest to you, talking about Muslims, in compassion, concern, and love for one another, are those who call themselves Christians. So I want to establish this connection among us right now of the oneness to show my words to be universal. I am a father, grandfather, great-grandfather. I am a student of scripture, a student studying under the honor of Elijah Muhammad, student of Imam Warf Deen Muhammad. So I think I can contribute, and I get it, and thanks for the opportunity to contribute some insights that I have learned along the way. God says that he has created every child of Adam honorable, every child honorable. And a human being was created to govern himself. To do this successfully, universal laws and divine principles must be practiced and adhered to. So government starts with the individual. Government is not outside of ourselves. Government is not who gets into the White House, the Haunted House, the Black House, whatever house. Government starts with the individual. Government starts with the individual, and the home and family environment produces government representatives. Today's youth may say, well, you know, it's my life, I can do what I want to do with it, my life. And that may be true, but from a parent position, yes, it is your own life, but can you understand that your life affects their life and every life of those who love you and care about you, who are concerned with your well-being? And when you suffer, they suffer as well, even worse. Now, dark and destructive clouds of confusion over our heads of the youth today in our community come from three things, several things, but the three main things. A polluted mind and body, whether from food, drink, contamination, intoxication, a product of wrong, has produced wrong thinking. Also, peer pressure, negative influences outside of your own self. And the thing that no one ever really talks about, but I think the previous caller kind of touched on it a little bit, promiscuity. Promiscuity, illicit sex, and the aftermath of ill preparation, immaturity, irresponsibility, lack of accountability, confrontation between the immature parents, producing excessive unnecessary stress, that blame, and in many cases, family division. Now let's talk a little bit about our neighborhoods, or what we call the hood, which is really what a hood is. You know, a hood is a place of concealment. It's something that you conceal, put over your head when you want to keep something off you, keep the weather off you, or hide. So most of our so-called neighborhoods are really just that, hoods, with a lot of wrongdoing taking place, and it's become a hideout and a sanctuary for wrongdoing. It becomes a neighborhood only when healthy interaction with neighbors take place. But a community has its members affect change, especially with civic and political leaders and those who supposed to who are supposed to represent them. That's where the community comes. So you go from a hood to a neighborhood to a community. But we are not really a community because we are in our homes, not reaching out to one another, all kind of things going on that we want to keep to ourselves, and producing things that take place in society. So we're living in a serious time, and this time that we're living is individual accountability. Now, society has produced a negative learned behavior that is contrary to human nature. Let me talk about human nature for a little bit. Human nature and human excellence and the criminal result is a result of not developing human excellence. Now, the first crime that one commits is crime against themselves. Wrong thinking, wrong intent produces wrong action. And this has developed in the personal life of the individual who is criminally crime-orientated or criminally thinking. Home, gang, media influences spill out into the street, into urban society. Allah, God says in the Quran, and we will not change the condition of a people until they change what is in their hearts. Criminality has become a pop culture. Pop music does not mean that its influence is your best, is in your best interest. It only means that it's popular. Devaluation of human life is produced by not valuing your own life. But remember that you are very much needed in the community as a human being. You're very much needed in the community or you would not be here, even with wrong choices being made. So as you may know, in urban societies, cities, the youth are tracked from elementary school, determined by location, zip code, parents, members of the household, income, etc., to project whether they will contribute to society or whether they will contribute to the prison popularity through truancy, fights to service, etc. And unless there's divine intervention, and this intervention comes in the person in the person of people, divine intervention is really here in the form of concerned community leadership that is sound and trustworthy, because in the excellent nature of the conscious human being, it's also a divine nature. In other words, you are human and divine.
Excuse me 1 minute. You're listening to the Art McCoy University Radio Show, the University of Common Sense, 1490 WERE.
Now, what are some of the resources for a healthy, productive organization? Whenever you're organized within your own individual self, doesn't mean education, doesn't mean class, status, amount of income, but whenever you are organized within your individual self, you will attract opportunity. This includes your thinking and behavior. You will attract opportunity. Gang association is an attempt to bond with like-minded peers supporting negative and destructive behavior that was either not corrected, supported, or tolerated in the personal setting, usually the home, or a false sense of acceptance and power. It's a false sense of acceptance and power. What are some of the solutions if we're going to be solution-oriented? First of all, we have to rebuild the image correctly of what it is to be a human being. What does it mean to be human? If you are acting or behaving like you are out of your mind, you may have to be shown your real human mind before you can get back into it. Remember, we are people not successful as criminals. We are not successful as criminals in our society. Rather, the criminal injustice system is successful in robbing you of your life and freedom. Now, because we were created to be a manager of our life and our environment. Quran says that man was created from toil and struggle. And resistance to unchecked appetite develops strong moral muscles. When you are angry, your emotions swell up inside you like an erupting volcano. And we are warned by our prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, he says, do not give in to anger. Hard to do sometimes. Say, but do not give in to anger. Because when you do, the landscape of your relations will become devastated as if hit by a hurricane.
All right. Before we go further, let's hold your thoughts right there.
All the uproar, which we understand about Trump accountability, it cannot compare with in our cities when it comes to individual accountability.
Personal individual accountability. We were created as a human being with a margin of freedom and responsibility to really be our own government, our self-government. What we see in the Senate, the legislature, the House, we see all of these things of people that are supposed to represent us. That's a form of government that comes really from the internal government of the human being. The human being was already created excellent to follow the guidance clocked into nature from the original pattern of the first human being, the first man, Adam, all the way to today, and we're his descendants. So we have to be accountable for our own actions.
All right, so in the black community today as a whole, dealing with black-on-black crime or whatever, do you see a major problem in our community is personal individual accountability?
Personal individual accountability not being acted upon, and also the pain body that we're carrying around with is unresolved. We're carrying around situations that happened to us in our youth, that happened to us generationally, sometimes in our parents, in our social group. It's called post-traumatic slave disorder, even all the way from the institution of slavery. But we're carrying around pain that is undressed and unchecked. And therefore, when we act out, we want to cause pain to someone that looks just like us, because we remind ourselves of the pain that's not being corrected.
All right, okay, all right. So therefore, again, the question is, because of the condition as a whole of many of our community, we're too worried about Trump and not about our individual accountability. Is that what you're telling me?
We're always the people giving our energy to everything else but ourselves. We seem to think that if we do this, we'll be accepted by the greater society. Giving energy and credence to everything but ourselves. Whatever happens in the White House, what happens in the haunted house, is usually people manipulating things to scare you, spook you, okay? That is not going to affect us, because we're simply thinking that it's going to be some handouts or something how we can benefit without wanting to benefit ourselves. But the structure of every community and every society is to do for themselves. Yes, use opportunity that the government will present.
Yes, sir.
But the structure of government starts with the individual. When you make up in your mind that you're going to be accountable and responsible for your actions and build your integrity based on a human action that you already have, that's already in your nature, you will begin to excel. It doesn't take education, doesn't take a social setting, doesn't take wealth. It takes the determination just to be who you're to be.
So you're becoming very clear to me. So if that happens within yourself and in your community, it doesn't matter what happens with the Trump hysteria. No. We're moving forward.
No,
right?
Because you're dealing with divine universal law. Divine universal law is clocked into us. It's in the universe. It's in nature. It's in everything. Nature responds to you, and you respond to nature. When you go against your excellent created human nature, nature will come against you. If you go too far, there's always what you call a rope that God will give you, and what you call his all-forgiving, most merciful. Really, the only thing that you have to do is have a sincere, repentant heart, no matter what you have done or who you are. If you are sincerely sorry for who you once been and once did, once you wake up to your humanity, God will forgive you, and you can start all over again. This is what most people don't realize. They think I've been born in sin, shaped in iniquity, I'm cursed, I won't be nothing, I'll never be nothing. That's not true. God says we have created every child of Adam honorable and caused him to have an honorable destiny and a good life, every human being. But it's the influences and the circumstances that cause you to go contrary to your own human nature. And if you continue to do that, even though things will happen to try to force you back to come back into your senses, if you continue to do that, then you bring upon yourself circumstances.
So drifting off of the subject matter for just a little bit, so when I speak of the suburbanites need to atone for their sins, for the way they treated the black community when it came to the addiction, the plague that plagued the black community for all these years, yet they sit back snobbish and did nothing, by me asking them for an atonement is not wrong, did it?
Not at all. You know, the scripture says, honor thy father and thy mother so the days of our life will be long. And we are the fathers and mothers of all people on the planet. We're the original people. They know that. They know that. So, and we're one people. We're one spirit. So what I'm saying is that once you honor and reverence where you came from, and not be preconceived by notions of superiority or being better or I have more, because that can change overnight. What did this do for billionaires that are lined up into the White House all of a sudden lose their health? What good is the money? What happens when the money goes is devalued and billions of dollars are not worth anything? If you have a critical disease, what can you do with your wealth? Not a thing. So the real wealth is your humanity. Let's not be fooled. The real wealth is your humanity and the human spirit, and all of the access to power come from the one who created you.
So relating this to the condition of our community right now, how can we be uplifted by your message?
First, what you can do, love yourself. Love and accept yourself. Stop putting yourself down as a people. You know, we make it a culture to talk about one and to criticize one another when there really is something we like about that person. Stop putting yourself down because you're different, not having the same talents or gifts. Each one of us has a special individual gift. And remember this, there's not another one like you. Everyone, even twins, there's differences. Not another one like you. Remember that. And Allah says, surely I have created you from a single seed, humanity, that produced nations and tribes, and created you different so that you may know one another and not despise one another. So regardless of what you hear and see on so-called reality TVs, wailing out, Nick Cannon wailing out, all these things, LA Housewife, stop being something that you're not. Yourself is the very best. I love it when you can enhance what you are about. I'm not saying don't do anything to enhance your product, but be true to your nature, and nature will be true to you, and nature will not punish you and bring about your demise by you going contrary to your own human nature.
Yes, yes. You want to close. Go ahead. I didn't mean to interrupt you.
So briefly.
Go right ahead.
Here's some solutions. Let's be solution-oriented, because we've talked about this thing, crime, for a long time, and we will continue to talk about it.
Go right ahead, sir.
But let's be solution-oriented. First, let's rebuild our image. Let's rebuild our image.
Take your time. This is the Art McCoy University Radio Show, the University of Common Sense, 216-578-1490, streaming live all over the world. www.newstalkcleveland.com. www.newstalkcleveland.com.
Also, much of the senseless violence that is taking place and occurring in the inner cities, and especially among social groups, it is because, as I said before, of unaddressed social ills and what is known as the pain body of the individual, sometimes often masked, sometimes medicated, but not eradicated. This violent act to cause hurt and pain is really caused by the perpetrator of the crime because of their own pain and eroded self-image. In many cases, this pain is inherited from the parents, and in our social group, it is generational, the effects of after effects and the after effects of slavery. This is what is meant by post-traumatic slave disorder. The suffering ego of the person, in an attempt to defend the demeaned self-image, does not rationalize the violent act as criminal, but in their distorted thinking, as a justified right of the person who is now placing the blame on self and those who look like self for the pain that they are and have experienced. So much so that the desire to be, look, and act like someone else is a constant preoccupation, and they are becoming and have become false to themselves.
All right, on that note,
criminal-minded youth is this. If you can risk your life doing wrong, then why don't you risk your life and save your life doing right?
Great.
We're going to continue to come up with solution-orientated dialogue. But one of the things that briefly I might stake is putting together a skills bank, also behavior modification and dialogue with sponsors and mentors, as well as faculty.
All right, thank you so much.
He said, go on, go your way. You're healed, you're whole. So you make your life whole by condoning, by healing, by a repentant heart, by turning things around, doing things differently. Never too late, never too early. You say you're whole. Once you become a whole human being, human life unfolds to you.